हेलो, गुड इवनिंग। हेलो हेलो हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल?
हाँ हेलो सर।
हाँ, एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस सर।
हाँ, ओके। सो गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल। वी आर मीटिंग हियर थ्रू जूम आफ्टर अ वेरी लॉन्ग ब्रेक। I hope all of you are in very good health and taking care of your family and you against this corona, which has threatened to the whole world. So today, with this meeting, we are going to discuss about the unit number 4. The unit number 4 here is about to ignition system. So in this ignition system, we are going to see about the need, basic ignition circuit, types of ignition system, ignition system, component details and working, magnetic ignition system, electronic and distributorless ignition system, waste spark and pylon plug system, and lastly, ignition timing with respect to that spark advance and retarding mechanism. So under this unit number 4, we are going to take the review of what are the different types of the ignition systems that are being used in automotive vehicles. What are the different components of that ignition system and how they works. So before going to start this ignition system, let's have some recap. That is, we already know that this automotive electrical and electronic course is having different 6 units. So the first unit, we discussed about the various electrical systems and accessories which are being fitted in automobiles. Under the second unit, we discussed about the energy storage devices of the automobile, that is automotive batteries, basically the lead acid battery, and the very recently what we are utilizing in electric vehicles is the lithium ion battery. What are the different construction details and how we can test at all the batteries. The third unit, that is the last unit, we've seen that starting and charging system. So the charging system and starting system, which is fitted on the engine. So similar to that, in this fourth unit, we are going to see the ignition system, which is required for especially the spark ignition engines. So after this fourth unit, in the next unit, we are going to see about the automotive electronic systems. And the last unit, we will discuss about the sensors and actuators. So this was the just a recap of our earlier 3 units. So in the unit number 4, that is under the ignition system, at the end of this unit, what are the different outcomes expected from the student point of view? So I have listed here UEL01, that is UEL1, unit learning outcome 1, wherein it states that describe the purpose and detailed classification of ignition system. Second, it is the illustrate the purpose, construction and operation of battery ignition, magnetic ignition, electronic and distributorless ignition system with the help of circuit diagram. Then third, it explain the construction and working of spark plug, distributor, condenser, that are the major components of any type of the ignition system. Then fourth learning outcome is differentiate between conventional and electronic ignition system, because you are observing that many electronic systems are being used in automotive sector. So we are also utilizing the electronic ignition system on now every vehicle. So what is the difference between this conventional and electronic ignition system? Then unit learning outcome 5, explain the waste spark and pylon plug ignition system. These are the new concepts. Now these are not remaining the new concepts. Already this type of the ignition systems we have already implemented in many vehicles. So we should know what is the fundamental principles behind this waste spark and pylon plug ignition system. And last one, it is very important as far as IC engine performance is considered. Through the ignition system, we are igniting the air fuel mixture. So at what time you are igniting, that is the illustrate the term ignition timing and describe various advance and retard mechanisms. So in the last of this unit, we are going to discuss about the various types of advance and retard mechanisms that we are going to use in the ignition system. Now, before going to start, what is the ignition system and how it works? What are the classifications? let us define this ignition system. So before defining the ignition system, observe this particularly simple layout, simple sketch which shows the single cylinder engine in which there is a piston connecting rod, then this is the cylinder, and this single cylinder is having the two different intake valves and two different exhaust valves. That means as far as conventional that is engines are considered, we were utilizing per cylinder two valves, one inlet and one exhaust. But in this case it is shown that two inlet and two exhaust, because in many now engines which we are utilizing for cars, that engines are having the 16 valves, that is four cylinder and every cylinder is having four valves. So 4 × 4, 16 valve engines we are utilizing for now present cars. Now how it works now? In the first, that is last semester, you already studied how the engine works. So we are having the different two stroke, four stroke. We are generating the four stroke, compression, then power stroke, and then your exhaust stroke. So here at the center, you are observing the spark plug, which is the component of your engine. So with respect to this, how we can define the ignition system? That is simple definition is, this is a system that enables us to ignite the air fuel mixture in spark ignition engine. So here during the suction stroke, we are sucking the air fuel mixture through this intake port. That air fuel mixture, we are compressing it, and at the end of the compression, we are supposed to ignite the air fuel mixture. Why it is at the end of the compression? At the end of the compression, temperature will be very high, the pressure will be very high, and for that, this will initiate, that is necessitate the combustible mixture requirement. Combustible mixture, many times we discuss that phenomena. What is the meaning of this combustible mixture? So this ignition system is not only used for petrol engines, but this we can use for your gaseous engines like as the LPG or the alcohol engines or various alternative fueled engines. So why this is necessary? So first, it is necessary on gasoline engine to ignite the air fuel mixture, because after compressing the air fuel mixture, this air fuel mixture is not self igniting. This requires some ignition, because in compression ignition system, as far as diesel engine is considered, the temperature at which we are compressing it, that will go up to the self-ignition temperature of the diesel. That's why in compression ignition, it is not necessary to supply the additional source for igniting the air fuel mixture. But as far as gasoline engines are considered, the combustion, that is self-ignition temperature, is very high, and to achieve that much very high combustion, that is self-ignition temperature, it is not possible. So we need to have the separate means to ignite the air fuel mixture through this ignition system, which produces an extremely high voltage surge, which operates the spark plug. So to operate the spark plug, where the spark jumps from the central electrode to earth electrode, spark takes jump, and when the spark jumps, the spark takes place, and this spark will ignite the whole air fuel mixture, which is being compressed. And last one, an electric arc jumps across the tip of each spark plug at the correct time, causing the air fuel mixture to burn. So this is the definition and need of the ignition system. Is it clear to all? Yes. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So as far as ignition system is considered, we need to first identify, or we need to first clarify why it is required and what are the different conditions or factors on which it depends. So what are the functional requirements now of the ignition system? Why it is required? Because if you see, you already might have seen the spark plugs which we are utilizing in our day-to-day life, even in our two-wheelers, you might have seen that spark plug. So how the spark plug looks, what is the tip, what is the spark plug gap. Many times you might have also removed that spark plug if your engine is not running. So what are these functional requirements for this ignition system? So ignition system supplies a spark inside the cylinder, And this spark we are supplying at the end of the compression screw, so that compressed air petrol charge or air fuel charge we can ignite. So air fuel mixture is having the different strength. That is, we are knowing that there is a stoichiometric air fuel ratio, lean mixture, rich mixture, and again depending upon the compression ratio. All these compression ratio, mixture strength, how the combustion takes place inside the engine cylinder, what is the combustion phenomena in SI engine, CI engine, already you have studied in the IC engine. So all this you need to recall for this particular ignition system, because that are much important to link whatever you already studied in the IC engine. So in the ignition system, when we are having the normal atmospheric conditions. At normal atmospheric condition means, what is the atmospheric pressure we are having? Can you give any answer? What is the atmospheric pressure? Yes, anyone?
1 bar.
What is the atmospheric pressure presently? Because many times we have seen that atmospheric pressure, how it is defined and what is the exact value as far as international standard is considered. Atmospheric, international standard atmospheric pressure, we are saying that 101325 Newton per meter square or 101 kilopascal, isn't it? Or 760 mm of Hg, that is mercury. So under this normal atmospheric condition, a voltage of 223 kilovolt is required for a spark to jump if the air gap is of 0.6 mm. And we need to remember what is the spark plug gap. And this spark plug tip gap ranges from 0.3 to 0.8 mm. So with considering this 0.6 mm gap under the normal atmospheric condition, it requires 2 to 3 kilovolt. Because many times in the interviews, the question gets asked, why you require as many kilovolt? That is, for ignition system, we need to provide more than 20 kilovolt or 30 kilovolt. In modern engines, as the technology advancement takes place, it demands 35 kilovolt, 40 kilovolt, isn't it? So why this much very high voltage is required at a spark plug so that the spark can jump across that particular air gap? So this is the one basic simple thumb rule. That is, for normal atmospheric pressure, you require 2 to 3 kV. And we are knowing that is during compression stroke, we are compressing the air fuel mixture. And this compression pressure is not 1 bar. It is more than that. So as the pressure inside the engine cylinder during the compression stroke is very high, definitely to jump the spark across that particularly spark plug gap, the voltage required is tremendous. So take example, if the compression ratio is 8:1, that means if we take the atmospheric pressure 1 and the compression, for compression ratio with respect to 8:1, the compression pressure is 8 bar, then instead of 2 to 3 kV, they requires, that is that particular system requires 8 kilovolt. And this is again required with respect to, this again depends upon with respect to the, what is the mixture, whether it is a rich mixture, whether it's a weak mixture, whether it is a stoichiometric mixture, likewise. So this is just an example to illustrate how much high, very high voltage is required for the ignition system. Another one very important is, ignition system transports, because in automobile we are utilizing the storage, that is battery voltage is nearly 12 volt. In many vehicles now we are utilizing the 24 volt. So for 12 volt, from that we require to generate or we have to transport this 12 volt into the required 20 to 30 or even 40 kilovolt. So that is the functional requirement of this ignition system. Why ignition system is required? Our source, normal source is battery, and this battery is of having the 12 volt. And from that 12 volt, we require to jump it for 8 to 20 kilovolt, or according to the various engine running conditions, it the great demand to raise this 12 volt to 40 kilovolt. And to convert this 12 volt to 40 kilovolt, we require this ignition system. Now, what are the different types of the ignition system and what are the particularly designing components? So while designing an ignition system, which factors need to be considered now? Any guess? Because we are knowing now what is the requirement of ignition system. Yes, one can share his view. What are the different factors which needs to be considered while designing an ignition system?
Required voltage.
Yes, koon sangu shakel?
Required voltage.
Required voltage, yes. Required one, that is what is the required voltage that need to be considered, correct? Any other?
Wire size.
Wire size, correct. Any other?
Cost.
You are coming to the point, yes. All of you are now coming to the topic. Very good. Anyone can add? Because such type of
spark provided
might be asked in your maybe campus interviews or wherever you go as an automobile engineer. So while designing an ignition system, what are the most important? So here I will add, that is the first and very important is combustion chamber design. Why it is combustion chamber design? Because combustion chamber design itself speaks about what is the compression pressure, compression temperature. Because at what temperature I want to ignite that air fuel mixture, if I am knowing, then I can calculate by the thumb rule how much kilovolt is required, isn't it? Because in earlier case we seen that is 2 to 3 kV is required for atmospheric condition. That is 1 bar. If the combustion, that is compression pressure, is 20 bar, how much expected kilovolt is required, isn't it? So this is the first and very important combustion chamber design. And that's why it is always said that one cannot design the engine components or engine system components isolately. One need to integrate, that is integrated approach is required. That is we are calling as a concurrent approach. Everyone is required to be think over, because such components, such parameters are interlinked. Another one, it is an air fed ratio. If the mixture is very rich, then the kilovolt required may be different. If mixture is lean, then kilovolt requirement may be different. So that is the air fuel ratio. What is the mixture strength? At what engine speed the engine is running? What is the speed range? What is the load? With respect to these two, whatever we seen, that is the unit learning outcome 6, that is ignition timing. So this ignition timing is basically with respect to the engine speed and load. And for every parameter, that is engine load and separate engine speed, for both the parameters, we require to have the separate advance and retard mechanism that we are going to discuss later, because we are going to see the centrifugal advance mechanism, then vacuum advance mechanism. So for which parameter centrifugal advance mechanism is required, for which parameter vacuum advance speed, that is advanced mechanism is required, that we'll see. So this is the fourth and very important, that is engine speed and engine load. Then engine combustion temperature. So now one can see that engine combustion temperature, again, because inside the combustion chamber, when you are compressing the air fuel mixture, when you are compressing the air fuel mixture, at what temperature it is at the end of the compression? And this you can correlate with your cooling system design, because of the engine you are also utilizing the cooling system. So that cooling system need to be integrated here. Then next, it is the intended use. What is, for what purpose that engine is being used? Whether it is used for two-wheeler, for three-wheeler, whether it is used for four-wheeler likewise, or say heavy commercial vehicles, or your light commercial vehicles, or cars, or racing cars, likewise. And last and very most important, that is the emission regulations. Now this last, that is the emission regulations and your combustion chamber design, these one can correlate. This is the emission regulation and combustion chamber. Because combustion chamber design will dictate whether your combustion is taking place practically perfect one or not. Because the emissions coming from the engine dictate how your combustion is taking place. Taking place in the means whether it is a proper combustion or improper combustion, incomplete combustion, because emission regulations are related with the incomplete combustion. And now we are switching BS4 to BS6 norms, isn't it? Are you knowing that is from the 1st April, all the vehicles from the 1st April which are going to be manufactured should comply with BS6 norms?
Yes, sir.
So yes, sir. Why this we are switching from 4 to 6? Because this is also very relevant question we need to ask when we are discussing the equation system. Because whatever the technologies which are supposed to enter in the automotive sector, as far as BS6 norm is considered, that are not touched to this combustion chamber design. Because this combustion chamber design will dictate whether your combustion is complete or incomplete. And for that, it requires some time. So presently, many researchers are working on this combustion chamber design so that the optimistic design will be there, which will reduce the emission regulations. Now, why, how we are now getting the compliance for the BS6? That is by fitting the after treatment devices. That is, instead of concentrating on the combustion which is taking place inside the engine cylinder, now the shortest way is to control the emissions is to have the after treatment devices. And that's why in BS6 engines, after treatment devices are required to have mandatory, along with that OBD, onboard diagnostic system, MIL, that is malfunction illumination light, that we are going to discuss in the last unit. So in the sensors and actuators that are being incorporated now in upcoming. So these are the very important 7 factors which are required to be considered while designing an engine. Now, what are the requirements? Requirements of ignition system: it should be capable of producing high voltage, maybe up to 25,000 or 40,000, as the case may be. Second, it should produce spark for sufficient duration. That is also important. The spark duration should be sufficient so that all the mixture should be burned. And it should be for all operating speed, at every speed, every RPM. Then ignition system should function satisfactory at all engine speeds. It should not be satisfactory, that is, it should not give the malfunctioning at very high speed or at very idling speed. Longer life of contact points and spark plug. And now in many advanced ignition systems, now we are removing these contact points. Even we are removing the distributor also, wherein in the distributor we are utilizing the contact points. So there is a distributorless ignition system. Next, here spark must generate a correct time in every cycle of operation. So at what time the spark should occur, that is ignition timing, it is very, very important, and it varies according to the engine speed. The system must be easy to maintain, light in weight and compact in size, because this leads to the economy in the particular engine. There should be provision of spark advance with speed and load. It should be able to function smoothly even when the spark plug electrodes are deposited with carbon lead or spark. We are going to see that in the spark plug and distributor in detail, construction details, we will see how the carbon. Hello. I request participants to discuss. Yes, hello. I request participant not to discuss. Whenever I ask the questions, please raise that particularly your questions. fundamentals of principle of operation. And this is very important. We know that in 1819, Oersted discovered that an electric current could produce magnetism. And already this principle of operation we are studying in technology. Later in 1831, Michael Faraday discovered that the reverse was also possible. What is the reverse? That is, magnetism could produce the electricity. And that was called as, if you observe this diagram, it shows that there is a galvanometer, and this galvanometer is connected with the coil. And this coil, inside that coil, here the magnet is being inserted in. And this magnet is having the north pole and south pole. And as far as magnets are considered, this north pole and south pole, from north to south, these are the different magnetic lines of forces. From north to south, the magnetic lines of forces are going. From north to south, magnetic lines of forces are going. That is, this indicates that when you are pushing the magnet into the coil, the indicator swings to the right. That indicates that when you are pushing the magnet in the coil, the current is generated. And this current generated is given by the galvanometer. The reverse can happen also. So instead of pushing, we can pull out the coil from that particular coil. That is, pull out this magnet from that particular coil. So here again, you will observe that from the north to south, there are the magnetic lines of forces. Again, from the north to south, there are the magnetic lines of forces. So what happens here? When you are pulling or pushing or pulling the magnets into the coil, the electricity gets generated. When you are pushing, the indicator switch to the right. When you are pulling, the indicator switch to the left. Isn't it? That means whatever the magnetic lines of forces, when you are pushing this magnet inside this, that magnetic lines of forces gets cut by this coil. So when the coil cuts magnetic lines of forces, then electricity gets generated. That is the Faraday's law. That is the Faraday. Michael Faraday has discovered this particularly phenomena, which we are calling that is a Faraday's experiment. And now here he found that when the magnet was moved into or out of the coil, the galvanometer needle flicked one way then the other, as the galvanometer is sensitive to small amounts of electric current. Faraday noted that current is generated only when the magnet is moved. If the magnet is not moving, the current is not going to move. And the direction of the current flow depends upon the direction of movement of the magnet. His conclusion was, current is induced into a circuit when a coil winding cuts magnetic lines of force, which occurs around a magnet. And this particular principle, we are calling it as an electromagnetic induction. That is, when current is generated in this way. How? That is, when current is induced into a circuit, when coil winding cuts magnetic lines of force, which occurs around a magnet. This is called as an electromagnetic induction. And this is the working principle of ignition system. So how much current generated by that depends upon the three factors. The length of the wire in the magnetic, that is the number of turns of the coil, as well as hello? Is there any question till date? Yes? Any question? Any question? Yes? Hello? Hello.
Hello, sir. I was not clear. I quit.
Okay.
Hello.
Might be the problem of internet connectivity.
Hello.
No, sir.
Yes, anyone?
Hello.
No, sir.
No, sir.
Any question? No? Shall I go ahead?
Hello.
Shall I go ahead?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So the current generated in the coil depends upon the three factors. First, of coil, that is the number of coil. Then second, here it is the relative speed of the movement between the magnet and the coil. And very much important, that is the strength of the magnetic field. So what is the strength of that magnetic field? That also decides the current generated. Okay. Now, the basic principle of spark generation. After 10 minutes, we will finish this particular lecture. So, a spark is an electric arc generated by the spark plug when a high voltage in the form of 10 to 20 kilovolt is applied to its terminals. Here you are observing that this is a point and condenser, and this is the ignition coil, which we are calling it as a transformer, because this is achieved by an electric transformer, which we are calling it as an ignition coil. And this electric transformer you have studied in electrical technology. So ignition coil is nothing but it is the transformer wherein we are having the primary winding. This is the primary winding which are having the less turn, and this is the secondary winding which are having the very high turn. Many turns are there. So this primary winding, an electric current circulates in the primary winding. So from this particularly source, when we are closing these points, from the source, the current flows through this, voltage flows through this, and it is connected to the primary winding, isn't it? So when we are having the points close, that is particularly the current flows through the primary winding. When we are switching off, either mechanically or electronically switch, when we are switching off, what happens here? There is a sudden drop. Because when current is passing through this primary winding, at that time surrounding to that, there will be the magnetic field generated. And when suddenly we are breaking this point, what happens? Whatever the magnetic field generated here surrounding to that primary winding gets collapsed. There is a sudden drop in magnetic field generated by the primary winding. And this sudden drop, this abrupt drop in magnetic field induces a very high EMF in the secondary, and that high EMF, that is electromotive force, that is voltage, we are taking out through this particularly main wire which we are connecting it to the spark plug. So how much secondary voltage we desire, that depends upon what are the different, how many turns are there from the primary winding and how many turns are there in secondary winding. So that is the very important. So if you see the spark generation here, I am presenting here the primary current and voltage waveform, wherein this is the secondary, that is primary waveform, and this is the secondary waveform, in which at particularly zero, when you are we require that is very high voltage. So this is the point. So this is the primary on. When we are making the primary on current passes, and when suddenly we are making the primary off, what happens? There will be suddenly very high voltage. That is, when we are making the primary on, the current will pass and it will reach the highest value. That may be 12 volt. But when I am making the primary off by disconnecting the contact point, then suddenly from 12 volt, it will become 0 volt. Isn't it? But for the secondary, this 0 to volt here, this particularly 12 volt will remain same. But when I am making the primary off, there is a sudden increase in the secondary voltage, and that is in the range of your in kVs. So you can see here, we are dropping from 12 volt to 0, but from your 12 volt, we are increasing up to the 25 or 30 kilovolt. So this is the basic principle of your spark generation. So we will just go through that.
Hello.
One of the different types of the ignition systems: battery ignition, magneto, electro.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, there is one doubt about the condenser.
Yes, yes.
Sir, as we manually switching on or off the primary coil, then yes. What is the role of condenser in the system, sir?
Yeah, we are going to discuss when we are going to discuss the in detail battery ignition or magnetic ignition system. Might be in next lecture, we will cover that. At that time, we are going to see not only the condenser, but in detail the functioning of distributor, spark plug and all. At that time, we will get clear idea. Okay?
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay.
So these are the types of ignition system: battery ignition, magnetic ignition, electronic ignition, distributorless, waste spark plug, coil on plug, and capacitor discharge ignition. This last one we are generally utilizing in two wheelers. So today here we will end. So in the today's lecture we started basically why the ignition system is required, what are the functional requirements, what are the design considerations, what is the on which principle it works, isn't it? Then also in last we seen what are the types of the ignition system. I request all the participants to go through the websites and try to find out what are the different latest ignition systems which you are following or which you are observing in Indian automobiles. Tomorrow, that is in the next lecture, we are going to see the in detail battery ignition system and magnetic ignition system. All these systems we are going to see in detail in this particularly unit number 4. So if any doubt, you can ask. I have gone through the WhatsApp app TY Automobile. Many students are facing the problem of internet connection. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Don't be panic because of that. Only you need to stick with the timetables and try to attend many lectures as because you are going to be supplied with all these video recordings through maybe YouTube or at the institute level we are trying to get the Telegram app. So that through that Telegram, just like as a YouTube, our faculty members will upload the recorded videos of these online lectures on the Telegram, or they will provide the YouTube link or the link on the Moodle, because many faculty members have already started to upload videos on Moodle, but if we are uploading such type of the very high data of the Moodle will not work properly. We are instructing faculty members not to upload full video on Moodle. So instead of that, faculty members will share you the YouTube or Telegram link or that particular link from the Zoom, so that you can from that link you can download and you can observe that. So don't become panic because of the very that is internet
hello.
All the students to attend regularly the online classes and take care of yourself as well as your family from the coronavirus. Don't go outside. This is the sincere request from my side to because this particular coronavirus is threatening to whole world. So we need to take care of ourselves as well as our family members. If you are having any doubts, you can share it to respective faculty members through the WhatsApp or through the emails or through the Moodle discussion forums. And one important don't write on the screen. So important announcement as far as ISC second component is considered. Let me know how many groups have completed their ISC second component of automotive, electrical and electronics. Otherwise, I have to make the alternative solution. I will give one email, might be tomorrow, to all of you. Respond to that email. And after getting your responses through the email, I will rearrange the ISE, and according to that, you need to complete that ISE. Maybe day after tomorrow, I will upload the PPTs as well as video link on the Moodle. Everyone are expected to go through that and I sincerely request to all of you that I give the prompt reply to every email, every question being raised by the faculty members. We are praying for your betterment only.
Yes, sir.
Take it in negative way. Take it in positive way, and try to attend all the online lectures. Though you are facing the internet problem, don't get panic. You will be supported fully from each and every faculty member by giving
sir, the attendance
Moodle through the email. Okay.
Attendance.
Are discussing this. Maybe on the Monday there will be the academic review committee meeting. Just like online lectures, last Monday also we conducted the meeting, online meeting with Director Madam and Dean Academics. I have already raised this point in that meeting. So definitely the higher authorities will take it into consideration. So don't panic because of that particular attendance criteria. Okay,
but due to internet problems,
as possible as you try to attend lectures, because this is for benefit of you. Okay, any doubt?
No sir.
Okay, then we will end this meeting. So thank you for attending this meeting. We will meet now on Monday.
Thank you for conducting the lecture, sir.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Meeting ideas.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, while lecture is ongoing, sometimes the audio is not clear.
Yes.
I think
this is main issue, sir.
We are not getting
a main concept directly. We are trying to make it on PPD. So
yes. There are so many constraints in these online lectures because of that connectivity, or so many problems are there. We are working on that, and as soon as we get the solution, we will come to you. But till that, you can attend regularly and as many as possible.
Hello. So we can adjust that on theory subjects, but for numerical subjects we can't do that.
For numerical subjects we are thinking about crash course once we resume the college after this lockdown situation. Once we resume the college, we are going to have the crash courses for mathematical related subjects, even for practicals. Now for practicals, every subject teacher of that particular practical course will upload the manual or related material on Moodle. Everyone should go through that, prepare the write-up of that. And practicals are also, we are planning to have the crash course. For the single one practical, we may have conduct 2 to 3 practicals simultaneously.
Sir, we can't write the experiments now. No, we don't have the pages.
Okay. In that particular case, you should go through that particular whatever the materials given through the Moodle and try to understand related to that particular laboratory experiments. Okay.
Are submissions going to postpone?
This is not yet decided. That depends upon how much time we are getting after rejoining the college. Because this is not our only one's problem, RIT's problem. This problem is being faced at national, international level.
Okay, sir.
So, okay, thank you. We are now ending this meeting. Thanks for attending. So, I will pick up from you on the Monday. You same.
Okay. Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you.